To fluid statics session 2. I am Professor Vivek Sathe of WIT Solapur. Now, before starting with the second session, once again we'll see what are the outcomes. At the end of this session, learner will be able to identify properties of fluid like pressure is isotropic, pressure is uniform on a horizontal plane, and fluid exerts pressure at right angles. See, these are very important outcomes, and if you understand these outcomes in detail, then you will have, say, comfort in solving so many numerical problems in fluid mechanics. Okay, now let us go back to the first session. The question I asked you about whether the pressure is scalar or vector. Many students have confusion and they say that pressure is a vector quantity. The simple reason is they say that pressure is force upon area, and as force is a vector and this is a scalar, area is a scalar, they say that it is a vector quantity. Now basically, if I ask students what is the difference between a scalar and vector, many students tell the by-hearted definition that a scalar is a quantity which has only magnitude and there is no direction. So only magnitude, it is called as a scalar, and only direction and magnitude, it is called as vector. Then I ask a simple question. If I take an electric current, for example, suppose this is electric current coming through, this is electric current going from this, and suppose the angle between this is 90 degrees, this is I1, I2 and I3. Suppose I1, I2 and I3. If I say I is equal to I1 plus I2 plus I3 by Kirchhoff's law, and if I change the angle by from 90 to 45 degrees, will there be any change in the output? Then the students say no. Still I1 is equal to I2 plus I3. Means current has got direction as well as magnitude, but it is not a vector. Means only direction and magnitude is not the necessary condition for any physical parameter to be a vector. Then what is it? So it is that it must add as per the vector law of addition. Means whenever I add this vector to this particular vector, and if the addition takes place according to the triangle law or law of parallelism of forces, then only it is called as a vector. But regarding the pressure, whether it is a scalar or a vector, I'll give a simple example. Pressure is basically not force upon area. Many times students make mistake, it is force upon area. It is thrust upon area. What it is? It is thrust upon area. What is thrust? Suppose I have this wall and I apply this force like this at an angle some theta. Then this has got two components. One component is along the plane and second is perpendicular. The component which is perpendicular, that is the thrust component, is responsible for giving me the pressure. And component which is along the tangent is responsible for giving me the shearing. So when we talk about the pressure in fluid statics, we are interested in this thrust. And that's why I asked in the last session about the question that when this balloon is having the holes and the piston is pressed inside, water will ooze out normally. It will come out radially. So if you just trace all the locus, you will find that all the points are assumed to be coming from the center of the curvature. Means it is in the radial direction going out, and this makes it clear that pressure is nothing but thrust upon area. Then what is thrust? So this component is nothing but it is F dot N cap. So when I take around the normal direction what is the component present and divide it by area, what I get? This is a dot product. Dot product is a scalar quantity. It is a scalar product rather. So scalar upon scalar becomes a scalar, and hence pressure is a scalar quantity. That's why it adds like a pressure. That is, if I add, there is no addition like a vector quantity, it adds like a scalar quantity. Okay, I think this much is sufficient for you about the pressure, scalar or vector. Now we'll go to the next important parameter in this session, that is some properties of fluid. Now see, first important property is pressure is isotropic. Now first of all, there are two terms we use in mechanics. One is called as isotropy and second is called as anisotropy. What is called as anisotropy? So isotropic means the quantity is same in all directions. Now you can just see here, if I take a container in which there is a small element that I consider. Now this is a small differential element. For analysis, from the mathematical point of view, we take it dx, dy and dz. It becomes a small volume element that we call as the dv, which is equal to dx, dy and dz. And in the limiting case, dx, dy, dz tends to 0. And when they tends to 0, individually tends to 0, it becomes a point. It becomes a point. We will see exactly transformation from this to this, exactly how it happens. Now see what happens here. When I see the pressure acting on all the edges of this particular element, if the pressure on this axis, then the pressure along this axis and the pressure along, say, this axis, if they are not balanced, if they are not balanced, suppose this is my x, y and z axis. This is x, this is y and this is z. If I use the right-hand rule, this is, say, x, y and z. So if net x component is present, then what will happen? Fluid will have acceleration to the right side. If net y component is present, fluid will have acceleration in the y direction. If net z component is present, fluid will have component in the z direction. So as my fluid particle is at rest, because I am interested in fluid statics, it is clear that this force and this force is same, this and this is same, this and this is same. So in a nutshell, what I can say that this mass, elemental volume, if I compress it, it will become a point mass. And I will show that the pressure is compressive. So the pressure is always compressive. There is no concept of tensile pressure. Tensile stress is there, but pressure is always compressive. And in static pressure, when we show it on the Mohr circle, it will be a point. It will not be a circle because there is no shear. There is no movement of the fluid taking place. So this is the first point, that is, pressure is isotropic. Another important thing is pressure is uniform on a horizontal plane. Now this is a important property, and students have confusion regarding the same pressure along the horizontal line for two cases. Suppose this body is moving with uniform velocity, Now what is the meaning of uniform velocity? There is no acceleration. Uniform velocity means acceleration is zero. When acceleration is zero, by Newton's law, we can say that there is no external force acting on the system. Or when the body is moving in a vertical direction and we want to measure the pressure in the horizontal direction, it remains same. Now let us see how it works. Suppose I take the cylindrical element here, where the cross-sectional area is A, pressure here is P1, pressure here is P2. And cross-sectional area, say, is ds here, point is A and B. So at A, the force is P1 into ds. At B, force is P2 into ds. Now what happens, if this is both are equal, then only the particle is in equilibrium. Otherwise not. If P1 ds is greater than P2 ds, particle will move to the left, to the right. If P2 ds is greater than P1 ds, particle will move to the left. But if particle is in a static equilibrium, what I get? P1 is equal to P2. So because of this, horizontal layer has got same static pressure. I am not talking about the dynamic pressure. It is a static pressure. Similarly, assume that this is moving with uniform velocity. When a body moves in uniform velocity, it is as if it is in the frame of reference static condition. So in that situation also, there is no change in the pressure along the horizontal line. So these are the isobaric lines. These are isobaric lines. Similarly, if I have an accelerated motion in the vertical direction, still my pressure in the horizontal direction is same. How? It is clear. Because whatever the pressure is coming on the top will be given by the reaction by the normal surface. But as far as the horizontal layer is concerned, it is not going to be affected by the acceleration in the vertical direction. But acceleration in the horizontal direction will change the pressure. That we'll see in the kinematics, in the most probably in the fifth session in detail. So this is first point. Then there is a hydrostatic paradox. Hydrostatic paradox, basically paradox means when we expect something and exactly reverse happens. Now see, if I show you this particular container here, in which there is a liquid, then there is some small pipe like this, in which there is another liquid, and some intricate geometry like this, where there is some liquid. But one thing I keep constant, that is the height. Suppose head is constant, then the pressure here and pressure here, at this point, and this point is same. So pressure along the horizontal line is same, provided you are using same liquid. Means suppose I take one liquid here, another liquid here, another liquid here, another here, then pressure is not same. So whenever I draw a line like this, and if I am sure that when I pass from this point below this up to this point, and the fluid is same fluid, then automatically I get the same pressure everywhere, this point and this point. Because pressure is independent of the shape and size. It is independent. It is very important of shape and size. It depends only on the height. So how much height of the liquid you have on the container, that will give the pressure. I'm not talking, asking you about what is the force exerted here. Force is different because force will be this area, this area, this area, and this area. So force may be different, but pressure is going to be same. So I think now from this, you have got an idea that as pressure is same, pressure is a scalar quantity, and when we compress the liquid, it will ooze out in the normal direction. And it has been made clear to you now that force upon area, though it is a definition of a pressure, it is a thrust upon area, and thrust is a scalar quantity, which is a force in the perpendicular direction. And because of that, we get pressure as a scalar quantity. So for any reference, I suggest you to go for fluid mechanics by White, by TMH publication. And for this test, today's session, we'll stop over here. Thank you.